Okay, well, good morning and welcome to this symposium on academic governance in the UK. I'm Anne Shepherd. I'm the chair of the Executive Committee of the Council for the Defence of British Universities. I'm going to chair this morning. I'm going to hand over to Annie Zesmel in the afternoon. And we've got a very full morning ahead of us. I do have just a couple of things to say about the programme. First of all, those of you who saw an early version of our programme will know that we were hoping that Lord Kerslake could be among our speakers, and I expect you will have seen that very sadly he died on the 1st of July following a period of quite serious ill health. Lord Kerslake was a very good friend to CDBU over the last year or so, and we were very sad to receive the news of his passing. We sent our condolences to his office to pass on to his family. On a more positive note, we're extremely grateful to SOAS and to the ICOP project, the In the Corridors of Power project, for allowing us to use this splendid venue for our event and to share the event with ICOP. And we're delighted that Professor Adam Habib, the director of SOAS, is able to welcome us with an introductory address. So I'm going to hand over to Adam now.
So colleagues, friends, thank you. I just want to first kick off by welcoming you all to SOAS. It's really a pleasure to have you here and to have you deliberate on what I think are really the fundamental issues of British higher education, issues of academic autonomy and freedom, issues of university governance. Initially, I had agreed to do a kind of welcome. And normally I do 5 minutes, welcome. It's really lovely, happy, do some marketing spiel about SOAS, and off I go. I couldn't do this time around. Alison said you can say a few words. And I jumped at the opportunity. So yeah, I'm going to, forgive me, but I am going to abuse my host's privilege and say and articulate four what I see as four provocations that I think are worth talking about. I should say I do so not out of disrespect. I really am a great fan of the UK universities. But I do so because I think they need to be said. And what I am going to say are issues that will seem critical, perhaps sometimes overly critical. And every now and then when I do mention them, I get into serious trouble. But I do think it is important to say them because I think they are issues that require deep, deep deliberation and they need to be reflected upon. You don't have to agree with them, but you do. I think we all need to collectively think them through. I should say, before I get to the provocations, a little bit about myself, partly because it'll give you some understanding of how my thoughts are informed. I am South African and I've spent most of my life in South Africa. Most of my life in universities and as an activist ever since I was, 17 or 16 years old. In that life, I often describe myself as having spent my first half of my life trying to break institutions, being a member of the anti-apartheid movement and committed to destroying the apartheid system. And then I spent the second half of my life trying to build institutions and enabling and inclusion. And in the course of that life, I have sat on a national commission in South Africa on academic freedom and autonomy and thought about it over between 2008 and 10 and published on it quite extensively. But I also served as the Vice Chancellor of the University of Witwatersrand during the tumultuous years of fees bus fall and had to grapple with that in quite significant ways. And so thought through issues around university governance and the challenges of universities in a very, very different setting. And then came here for the last 2.5 years in SOAS. And SOAS is an interesting place in many ways. It's a precious place. But it is a robust place. And I've had a really interesting set of engagements over the last 2.5 years that I'm thinking through the issues of university governance and inclusion and challenges, etc. And so, in a sense, my thoughts are informed by both the last 2.5 years, but as much by my first 30 years in higher education, which was in South Africa, first as part of universities directed to breaking an apartheid system and then building a post-apartheid system. And South Africa's made huge, huge mistakes. And I've learned as much as from those mistakes as I have from its successes. So four provocations. The first, you cannot think of academic autonomy or academic freedom without thinking of public accountability. The two have to go with each other. But here's the challenge that most politicians, the mistake that most politicians make. They see public accountability or public assurance as being granted through state institutions. But there's a fundamental difference between public accountability and state accountability. And it's an important difference that has to be understood. Because states are by their very nature, although they may be democratically elected in democratic societies, they are constrained by a whole series of short and medium term challenges. And they are constrained to make choices within the framework of those constraints. But universities are meant to cast a longer term gaze. They need, in some senses, to be freed from the strictures of time-bound decisions, while being pragmatic enough to understand that they are limited by them. So you have to be pragmatic enough to understand that money makes universities work, and you have to think that through. But you can't be simply driven by the short-term constraints of the balance sheet. And states often are. And in the modern democratic systems, states are driven by, frankly, what the next election requires them to win power in. And they make choices informed by that. And universities, particularly its governance authorities, need to be freed of that. And so in a sense, the way I see we need to think about public accountability is through plurality. Through within our governance structures, we need to reflect a plurality of interests, a plurality of thought processes. And each of these plurality, these separate interests and thought processes act as a check on each other. No one manages or constrains the other. But it is able in the struggle, in the intellectual struggle for determining decisions and choices, and you begin to act as a constraint and as a conditioning on the other. And so in a sense, I want to say public accountability and academic freedom and autonomy go hand in hand. But it's public accountability. And public accountability needs to be freed from state stricture to understand the collective of the public. And the collective of the public is its entirety in its diversity. And its diversity is not simply demographic. Its diversity is reflected in intellectual diversity, in resource diversity, in demographic diversity, in experiential diversity. What is fundamental in a university governance structure is the ability of people who are not in power, whether state power or institutional power, to be able to reflect their experiences. I love the idea of social movements, at least some representation of social movements and NGOs. But I would caution that you don't simply have social movements and NGOs sitting in a board, however democratic or left you think you are, because they can be just as constraining as other power holders in society. So it's complex. It's public accountability needs to be understood in enabling diversity of opinion, in enabling diversity of thought, each of which acts as a constraint on the other. So that's provocation one, which I suspect is not much of a provocation here. But the others will be. Provocation two. The UK university is under threat. It's under the essence of what the university is meant to be is severely under threat. A big part of that threat is the Tory government, I have no doubt about it, which has engaged in what I see as the most comprehensive intervention in higher education since the 1980s. But I think that the threat is bigger than the UK Tory party. And I think that the UK Tory party has been able to intervene in the way that it has, and has been able to intervene as comprehensively as it has, because frankly, universities have failed. The academy has failed. I have believed that there's an enormous amount of self-censorship happening in the university system. Ask any serious political scientist, sociologist, anthropologist, if they're happy and feel comfortable at writing about race or identity. And I promise you, if they say they are, they're lying. Or they have very, very odd views on the subject. And I come from a society in which university politics is really rough. You know, during Fees Must Fall, there was $2 billion worth of infrastructure burned in South African universities. But frankly, South African universities have a capacity to speak frankly. And when I walked in, I would have anticipated UK universities would have had the capacity to speak frankly. And I've spent time in UK universities. I spent a sabbatical year 10 years ago in Oxford. And I'm struck by how many academics feel scared to say things publicly, in part because of social media, in part because of the backlash, in part because of all kinds of things. And I think that it's precisely, and Alison and I have debated this, and this is not about no platforming, allowing platforms or not. I think no platforming is, I don't know, less than 2%, Alison, of cases. I don't think that's the issue. But I think that there is a serious issue of academics saying to me, in many places, I'm scared to say certain things. More importantly, I'll tell you, as perhaps the director, vice chancellor of one of the most radical universities in the UK, you know how many times I've been told by my colleagues, close colleagues, don't say that publicly, Adam. It's going to annoy people, and they're going to come after us. This is, and I have no doubt that people have said it to me because they care. They're hoping to protect me. But imagine what it means for an institution that is meant to speak truth to power. We run around, all of us, the left and progressives, truth to power. And yet, I, as one of the leading leaders, executives of a radical institution in the United Kingdom, is continuously advised to say, don't say that publicly. It's going to annoy people. And that's something that poses some important issues. You can't talk about defending the universities if that fundamental function is not there. So I think that the failure, the ability of the Tory government to intervene as extensively as it has, is in part got to do with our failure to manage the universities and to constrain the intolerance that has emerged in our institutions. And that is a failure of the VCs. I've said this, by the way, in a public gathering, and a number of them looked oddly at me, but frankly, I've said this, it's the failure, the collective failure of VCs to play that role that has allowed this to happen. It's allowed a gap for the public, for politicians of the far right to intervene and justify their interventions. Third provocation, the business model for UK universities is broken. And I think we're lying to ourselves if we think that that's not the case. The entire system is premised. Every academic is defined on 40% teaching, 40% research, 20% on average administration. There's fees from domestic students pays for the 40% teaching, if you're lucky, depending on which faculty you're talking about. In a place like SOAS, it does cover it. The 40% research time is frankly covered by international fees. It's frankly covered, and so is the 20% administration time. And it's unsustainable. By the way, it's immoral. So think, I just did an analysis, working out at Equitable Partnerships. We just did an analysis. What does it cost us per student economics PhD student. It costs us full cost, £4,500, full student per annum. This is the fancy buildings, heritage buildings, etc. We charge a domestic PhD student £4,700. We charge a student from Malawi £24,000. That's a 500% markup. I cannot think of the British government allowing any sector in the private sector, other than perhaps pharmaceuticals, to charge a 500% markup. And we do it as public institutions, and the cheek of it, people like me, the vice chancellors, do it in the name of social justice. We charge a 500% markup in the name of social justice. This business model is broken morally, but it's also broken strategically. Even if I was sitting in the Tory government, I would say, simply in strategic terms, would I want 45% of international students come from two countries, India and China? China I see as a threat. The Tory government has been all over the place. And frankly, India is not the most pleasant place at the moment. And those two governments constitute 45%. No government in the world subjects its higher education system to that vulnerability. If India and China close the doors tomorrow on their students, 80% of British universities, I say it, 80% go bankrupt overnight. It's an astonishing vulnerability. So forget the social justice side. Frankly, from a security angle, it's the stupidest thing I've ever seen. And so I would say the British higher education, from whichever angle you're looking at it, is utterly broken and needs to be rethought. The problem is, in a conversation I had with VCs, when we discussed it, everybody, we were having a debate on subsidy, and everybody said we need to get the right balance between subsidy and fees. Absolutely right. We need more subsidy. When I raised the issue, should we speak about international fee? You know what they said? It's a really difficult question. It's an important question, but can we move on and come back to it some other time? We're ducking the fundamental question. You can't talk about fees without talking about the immorality of international fees. And let's be honest about it. And then finally, British universities, including the executive, myself, its governance authorities, and frankly, its unions, have developed a self-serving interpretation of social justice. We need a far more expansive definition of social justice, to be honest. The definition we've developed is a self-serving one. You can't say we're doing this in the interests of social justice and have a 500% markup on your fees. That's a self-serving interpretation. And frankly, I'm going to say this, forgive me for saying this. You can't say to me, in the interest of social justice, we're doing a marking and assessment boycott. And the students from Malawi who've given up everything, taken the resources of their village so that they can pay a £24,000 fee, they must suck it up in the interest of the struggle of the working class, the British working class in UK universities. It's just a self-serving interpretation of social justice. It's shocking. Now, I'm not saying that British academic salaries have not been eroded over the last 15 years. Yes, they have. But if you want to fight on that, take it to 10 Downing Street. And then ask me as a VC to come and stand outside 10 Downing Street. But don't make the victims students, both domestic students and international students. And frankly, the leadership of the union has developed a self-serving interpretation of social justice. They are prepared in a fee cap environment to say, damn the people of the South, they should pay for the industrial disputes of the North. And that's, I think, a serious question. Now, I think we need to think about it. You may not agree with it, but we need to have an open debate on it. And it seems to me that you can't think about public accountability. You can't think about commitments to social justice. You can't think about all of the things we talk about without at least debating and deliberating on those issues. So one final thought. The UK higher education system is a significant resource, both for this country and for the world. I don't think we can survive as a global academy without the UK. But it needs some self-reflection, and it can't see itself solely as a victim of other stakeholders. British higher education would do well to recognize that it has agency to determine its own future. But this has to be done in a nuanced form without being paralyzed by the damaging battles it is increasingly becoming known for. Enough said. Welcome to SOAS. Really, I hope you have a fruitful deliberation. And really, again, I'm sorry to have said some of the provocations I have. It really is not meant as a sign of disrespect. It's meant as a sign of collegiality and, for want of a better term, comradely. Because I think if there's anything we need, is honest conversation. Thank you very, very much.
Thank you very much, Adam. I think some provocations is actually just what we need to start get a debate going. Although, I think we're probably going to get we're not going to be able to address all of those issues today. But thank you.